Here is a Sanyo VWM-800 4-head hi-fi VCR, which was definitely a low-budget design from the waning years of the VHS format in the early to mid-2000s. You can tell by its compact design and lack of an alphanumeric display, instead relying on a series of indicator LEDs. So at first glance, it looks very similar to the extremely common and cheap Last Gasp VCRs manufactured by Funai, which I made a video about. Although the top of the lid is actually made of metal, and it has some nice looking chrome accents on the cassette door. The only feature besides its Energy Star compliance, which it advertises on the front panel, is TVG technology. Yes, it has the TV Guardian foul language filter built in, and I'll link to the video by Technology Connections if you want to learn more about what that is and how it works. Thankfully, the TV Guardian is turned off by default, but it's the only VCR I've ever seen with a damn and hell option in its setup menu. And it's Y2K compliant and then some, supporting years up to 2100. And when playing pre-recorded tapes, it works just as well as any other VCR. It has hi-fi stereo and four heads, so you can get a perfect freeze frame when you pause it. So overall, works perfectly fine. But if I put in this tape that someone recorded from HBO in 1997, back in the era of analog cable TV, and I push this button on the VCR's remote, here's the intro of the movie from HBO, saying it's rated R, and there the movie begins. And now I'll press that enter button, and look at the display, it says Joan of Arc. And I press it again, it says it's 2.5 hours long and it's rated R. So somehow the VCR knows which movie we're watching, how long it is, and what the rating is. And if I rewind the tape to before the intro of Joan of Arc starts playing, it shows that the previous movie that HBO played was Tootsie, which is 2 hours long and is rated PG. Same thing with this tape, which was recorded from the Showtime channel in 2003. Again, once it's playing, I press the enter button, and it knows the name of the show, and even which episode it was. Those two tapes were both recorded from cable TV, so you may think that feature is something cable-specific, but here's a tape I recorded myself from over-the-air broadcast TV, WNBC Channel 4 in New York, back in 2002. When a promo for Frasier is playing and I push the button, it says NBC, and then in a few seconds when we get back to the show, we'll see what it says. And here we're back to the show, and I push it, and it says Extra. So even on over-the-air broadcast TV, it knows what was being watched and recorded. And the system is surprisingly robust, because this portion of the tape is in pretty rough shape, as you can see, and yet it's still able to identify it as a recording of Beverly Hills 90210. Now, I did not record this NBC tape on this Sanyo VCR. I was using a Panasonic VCR back then, which did not have this capability. And this model was introduced in 2002, so obviously it could not have been used to record this HBO tape from 1997. And yet, somehow, it is able to extract the information from these tapes, even when the equipment that was originally used to record them could not. And here's something really interesting I discovered. Even if I play the tape in this VCR from 1985, and I connect its RF output to the Sanyo VCR's antenna input, and I tune it in on channel 3 on the Sanyo VCR, and I push the button, it still displays the information on the TV screen. And in fact, now it even displays the call letters of the TV station it was recorded from, which it didn't do before. So that means the information is contained within the TV signal, and any VCR could record it and play it back, but only some of them have the ability to decode it. So that's what really caught my interest and got me searching for answers. The most logical first place to look is the VCR's owner's manual. And there it is on page 6. It says, easy information. If the extended data service, XDS, signals are provided along with normal TV signals in your area or during playback of a tape recorded with XDS signals, the station ID, program title, and program details are shown on the TV screen. And here they show it being used to display the station ID as well as program details including length, time remaining, and the rating. The best known and most widely used feature of XDS was its ability to automatically set your VCR's clock using the signal of your local PBS station. That capability was developed by Sony in conjunction with PBS and first appeared on two rather expensive models of Sony VCRs in 1994. But by the late 90s, it was available on several other brands of VCRs, including Toshiba. And I found this Los Angeles Times article from 2001, which said the vast majority of the 23 million VCRs sold in this country last year, which was 2000, came equipped with auto clock set. And they said all of Panasonic's VCRs by that point had the feature, as well as two-thirds of Sony's VCRs. This Sanyo VCR also has that auto clock set feature, but since analog TV is no longer on the air, it no longer works. Except if I can fake it, because thanks to Ben of the Oddity Archive, and I recommend you subscribe to his channel if you haven't already, I have on loan an October 13th, 2005 recording of Denver area PBS affiliate KBDI, which hopefully will contain that time signal. So just like before, I'm going to play this tape in one VCR and connect its RF output to the antenna input of another VCR with that auto clock set feature. So if this tape contains that time signal on the recording, hopefully that will fool the other VCR into thinking it's actually receiving that time signal over the air and cause it to automatically set its clock. But first, just playing this tape in the Sanyo VCR. Unfortunately, I'm not seeing any XDS program data, but I'm still hopeful that it might contain that time signal. I'm assuming it was possible for them to transmit the time signal without any of the XDS program data. I'm sure those were like two separate settings in the encoder, so they could have one or the other or both. So I'm still holding out hope that even though we're not seeing any of that program data, this recording might still contain that time signal. So here's the setup. I have the RF output of the Sanyo VCR connected to the antenna input of this Sony SLV-N81 VCR, which does not have XDS, but does have auto clock set, as it says right there on the front panel. Hey, wait a minute, look at this. The Sony VCR can display XDS data, but only through its TV tuner, not while it's playing a tape itself. It only works if you feed the output of another VCR through the RF output to the Sony VCR's TV input, then it will display the XDS data. Here's the Sony VCR's menu. Under settings, it has clock set, and you can choose either auto or manual. Obviously, I'll choose auto. You can either do full auto, or if you tell it no, you can actually tell it which channel to look for that time signal. So since that other VCR is putting out its signal on channel 4, that's what I'll tell it to look for. I'll leave time zone and daylight saving set to auto. And when I leave the menu, it says VCR will look for time signal after you turn it off. So I'll start that tape playing and I'll turn it off and I'll see what happens. It's flashing ACS, so it's definitely looking for that auto clock set signal. I'll see if it finds it. Well, unfortunately, after a few minutes, it stopped flashing ACS and just went back to the blank time display. So the auto clock setting was not successful, although I can tell it's at least trying to look for that time signal, because if I don't have that other VCR connected and playing a tape and I turn it off, the auto clock set gives up almost immediately instead of taking a few minutes. See, it just stopped right away. So that was a bust. Although Ben did say that KRMA is the main PBS station in Denver, while KBDI is sort of a lower tier, more independent PBS affiliate, so he wasn't sure if they would be transmitting the time signal. And indeed, either they weren't, or this method of trying to extract it from a VHS recording simply doesn't work. Another feature of XDS, which people may be familiar with, is commonly known as the V-chip, which was mandated by law to be included in all new TVs manufactured beginning in January 2000, and whose associated content rating system is still shown on screen at the beginning of TV programs today.
You know those rating icons you see on TV? There's one made for everybody. They work with your television's parental controls to give you control over which programs your family enjoys. So you can choose between watching TVMA, which is perfect for grown-ups, to watching TVG, which is also perfect for grown-ups.
This TV is from 2005, so it includes the V-chip functionality, so I can go into the menu here under Parental and enable the parental controls and set the movie rating to block anything R-rated or higher. I can put this Joan of Arc tape in my VCR, and even though it's a decades-old homemade EP mode VHS recording that will only give us a fuzzy, low-res view of whatever naughty or violent stuff is going on.
The following movie is rated R.
Now, as soon as we get past the intro, there it goes. It blocked the video because it knows I'm not allowed to watch R-rated movies. I can run the VCR in fast-forward mode to at least get a fast-motion glimpse of what's going on, but as soon as I return to normal playback, within like a second, it gets blocked again. Same thing with this tape, which has a recording of The Tonight Show with Jay Leno, which was rated TV-14. I can go into the menu and set it to block anything TV-14 or higher. Again, I can press play. And within a second, it gets blocked because it knows I'm not allowed to watch TV-14 rated programs. So the V-chip system works great, at least until a kid discovers that their parents never bothered to change the password from its factory default of quadruple zero, or in this case, quadruple nine, and then they can watch anything they want. All of this advanced technology was made possible by line 21 of the analog NTSC video signal, which normally sits out of sight and out of mind, in the vertical blanking interval beyond the visible edges of your TV's picture tube. Except if your TV's vertical hold is misadjusted, in which case you may see some flickering white lines on the top of the picture as it rolls by if the video you're watching was closed caption encoded. And yes, Technology Connections has a video about how that works as well. To give you a better idea of what's going on in that normally hidden part of the video signal, I'll use this Dazzle capture device, which includes enough of the overscan area that you can actually see it at the top of the video frame. First, a sample of this tape, which has no special encoding on it, and it looks completely normal.
Now let's get started.
Oh, thanks, Craig. I'm just gonna set these here for a minute. Can you smell that? I wish you could.
Next, this tape, which is closed caption encoded, and you can see some flickering white lines at the top of the image a few seconds before someone starts speaking.
Excuse me. Before we begin, I just want to remind all you kids, we're conducting an official meeting. We're not going to tolerate any disturbances.
And now this tape I recorded with that XDS signal on it, and there's a whole mess of stuff going on at the top of the picture. It almost looks like snow.
Extra, extra!
Only Extra was at the Beverly Hills launch party for Westlife's U.S. debut album, World of Our Own.
These kids, they are phenomenal. Amazing, amazing singers. Very focused, look good, nice guys. Brilliant. 20 million albums we've sold with them.
And now Westlife says they're ready to make America a world of their own.
All over again.
Thank you very much, America.
This may remind you of the methods of recording digital audio and computer data on VHS tapes, and that's pretty much exactly what XDS is, just on a much smaller scale, using a tiny sliver of the video signal which is not normally visible to the viewer. As for whether or not any pre-recorded VHS tapes have XDS encoding, I've never encountered it. In fact, it's disappointingly rare for any educational, instructional, or promotional tapes, which are the bread and butter of my collection, as you can see, to even have closed captioning. It certainly was possible. In 1995, you could get a rack mount closed captioning and XDS encoder for around $3,000, or a 16-bit ISA computer card to do it, which I'd really love to have, for around $1,900. But presumably, it was mostly just considered to be redundant, because unlike TV, where you may not know what is on a certain channel at a specific time, and it's helpful to have that information provided to you, with the videotape, if you want to know what the title is, how long it is, and what the rating is, you can just read the slipcase or the label, and that will tell you. Over the years, the vertical blanking interval of an analog TV signal was fertile ground for all sorts of data delivery systems, not just closed captioning and XDS, but also Teletext, which enjoyed many years of widespread use in Europe and other parts of the world, but was stymied in North America by multiple incompatible systems being developed and the high cost and scarcity of equipment to receive it. All the same reasons why AM stereo never caught on either. A much more limited form of teletext was eventually standardized in North America and included in most new TVs beginning in 1993, but it only had very limited use, and I haven't found any trace of it on any of my TV recordings. But some TV programs and videotapes did make use of closed captioning's rarely seen ability to display text in multiple colors. And then beginning in the mid-90s, there were systems which used a TV tuner card in your computer to receive web pages over the air through TV signals and send them to your computer's web browser.
You're really bringing the internet into the broad bandwidth of the television signal, is that right?
Exactly. The idea behind Intercast technology is to broadcast web pages with your existing television signal to a PC.
So what you're doing is stealing a little piece of the television signal bandwidth, and instead of delivering audio and video, you're sending me the internet-type data, right?
Actually, Intercast technology uses an unused part of the television signal that is partially used right now for closed captioning. Mm-hmm. So it's very similar to sending closed captioning. We're just putting web pages into that signal and broadcasting them.
And as for decoding XDS, if you don't have a VCR that supports it, unfortunately, we just missed out on that hubcap device that was advertised back in 1995, because recently there were a bunch of them on eBay selling for as low as $11.82 with free shipping. But if you ever come across one, it's a neat little, somewhat homemade looking box that just connects to any composite video source, and it has LEDs on the front panel that light up when it detects closed captioning, teletext, or XDS. And when it detects any of those services, it will display them through its video output and also spit out the data through an RS-232 serial port. And who knows, there could also be the aforementioned Intercast web pages lurking on old TV recordings. But trying to recover that data will need to wait until I have a period correct TV tuner card and the Windows 98 software for it.
Let's plug it in. It's going to say, hey, I see you plugged in a new device. And it's going to load in the appropriate drivers. You'll notice that this scanner build, whoa.